Hello and welcome to my series of conversations with men and women as ideas, vision and philosophy help define our contemporary world. My guest today is a graduate in English literature. He ran a construction business, lived sort of what's often described as on the wild side in the 60s, a fan of the Beatles, hang gliding, BMW and motorways. Today he heads the Isha Foundation, an international organization with hundreds of thousands of followers, dedicated deeply and committed to social work and social welfare projects. But most significantly, he's a teacher, a philosopher, embodying the highest aspirations of several Indian traditions. I suppose that the Hindu tradition preeminently. I'm delighted to welcome Sadhguru Vasudev. Tell me, sir, that you're described as Jagadguru. What is and who is a Jagadguru?
Oh,
do you describe yourself as one?
People describe me as a Sadhguru.
Uh-huh.
Sadhguru means an uneducated guru.
Uh-huh.
In the sense that one does not come from the scriptures or study of spirituality, but one who comes from inner experience. All I have is what I know within myself. I'm not scripturally read.
Is that a title that you're comfortable with?
It's not a title, it's more
description.
It's more a kind of description, so that people don't expect the Vedas or Upanishads or whatever else when they come and sit with you. There's only one thing I know. I know this piece of life absolutely, and that's all I know, and that's more than enough.
What about the guru aspect, the teacher, or what is a guru? What role do you see yourself? How do you see your work as a guru? What does it mean to be one? What does it feel to be one?
The word guru literally means gu means darkness, ru means dispeller.
One, so do you see yourself as dispelling darkness? Whose darkness? What kind of darkness?
when you say darkness, it's not in terms of light and darkness as we know physically. It's in terms of bringing clarity. When there is no clarity, you're in darkness. So bringing clarity of vision, bringing clarity of perception. What I'm teaching is fundamentally simple methods, a technology to enhance your perception. Because what you perceive is all you know. What you do not perceive, if you hear from somebody, it's just a fairy tale. And fairy tales don't transform you. It's only your perception.
What does someone like you pursue? Happiness? Equanimity? Well, you're enlightened, but a person who's sort of aspiring to be like you.
See,
is it legitimate to pursue happiness for oneself? What is happiness?
See, once you're joyful by your own nature, your life will become an expression of your joy, no more in pursuit of happiness. If you look back on your own life and see, most of the life may be in pursuit of happiness, but a few moments are an expression of your joy. They are the most significant and beautiful moments in your life.
Take us, beyond, the semantics of it. Joy, bliss, ecstasy, happiness. What is the aspiration?
So these are not semantics. This is living experience for people. Mm-hmm. We can say if your body becomes very pleasant, we generally call this health and pleasure. Mm-hmm. If your mind becomes very pleasant, we call this peace and joy. If your emotions become very pleasant, we call this love and compassion. If your energies become very pleasant, we call this bliss and ecstasy. So they are not really semantics, they are living experiences for people.
When you attain enlightenment, and we'll come to your experience of enlightenment, do you ever get unpleasant emotions? Do you feel, the pain of others, of the suffering of others? Is that a response to that, pleasant, unpleasant, or what? Or a third emotion, maybe I'm simplifying it because I have a limited vocabulary. What happens? You worked with the victims of tsunami and your people rushed there immediately. You go there and you see the suffering of people. What do you feel as opposed to, a mundane, stupid person like me? Just sort of fails, confusion. Why is this happening? What is this divine play? Why must people suffer? What do you feel when you see that?
See, if things were happening consciously within you, if your mind, if your emotion was happening consciously, if you see another person suffering, empathy will happen, compassion will happen, suffering will not happen. You can shed tears of compassion, you can shed tears of empathy, but they need not be tears of pain. And if pain comes, naturally bitterness will follow. So one cannot be in pain and avoid bitterness. If bitterness comes, all kinds of negative actions will follow. So the beauty of life is your inner experience, because the seat of experience is within you, you can 100% determine how you experience this life. Maybe you cannot 100% determine what situations you may face, what kind of situations you may be placed in, whether they're pleasant or unpleasant, you may not be able to decide that. But what happens within you is 100% in your control, because inside there's only one ingredient, which is you. Outside there are a million ingredients which nobody has total mastery over. We can control them and manage them to some extent, but never 100%. But this one, what's happening within, can be created 100% the way you want it. If things within you are happening exactly the way you want it, would you be creating bliss or pleasantness or unpleasantness? Definitely pleasantness, isn't it? No matter, especially if you're placed in unpleasant situations. Is it not all the more important that at least you keep your insides pleasant?
You're watching a conversation with Sadhguru Jaggi Vasudev. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away.
राजनीति और सामाजिक जीवन के विभिन्न पक्ष एक साथ आमने सामने
उसके बाद क्या
है वो यूनिवर्सिटी
हमारा उद्देश्य है दावों प्रतिदावों को आपके सामने लाना ताकि सत्य आ सके सामने और जनता की सहभागिता लोकतंत्र में बढ़े
रविवार रात 10 बजे सिर्फ डीडी न्यूज पर
वेलकम बैक टू कंटिन्यूइंग कन्वर्सेशन विद सतगुरु Jaggi Vasudev. We were talking about gurus, and there are so many gurus in the marketplace of spirituality. What are the yardsticks? What do you, you know, what are the criteria that as an aspirant one uses to evaluate and work or surrender or buy or whatever you want to use and respond to, learn from a guru?
So how to choose your guru?
Yes.
If you happen to go and sit with somebody who claims to be a guru, if you feel terribly uncomfortable with him, you don't want to be there for a moment, but you can't get up and go, but you keep going back again and again. Everything, all reason tells you not to go there, but something within you doesn't, helplessly goes there, that's your guru. If you like him, he's not your guru.
is the surrender or relationship with a guru, is it important to keep one's critical faculties alive? Are they yardsticks?
If it's only, if only we are following the path of bhakti, surrender becomes a thing. Surrender is not something that you can do. It is just that if you're overwhelmed by something far larger than you, a certain surrender happens. Nobody can surrender consciously. I have surrendered is a horrible statement to make. You cannot surrender. If a presence which is far larger than you overwhelms you in such a big way, a certain surrender happens. That is not full. People surrender in installments. So when it comes to me, I'm not demanding any kind of surrender. All I'm asking is sense. You want to work with something. You can only work with what you are. You can only work with what you have on your hands. You can't work with that which you don't have. You talk about surrender, devotion, God and this and that. These things you can't work with because you don't have them in your hands. What you have is your body, your mind, your emotion, your energy. You start working with that. And as it works for you, you will tend to go further and further naturally. Surrender is not always necessarily a must. It is… See, right now, whether you like it or not, we have surrendered to this planet because we are going wherever it goes, isn't it? So it is an unconscious surrender. So whether you like it or you don't like it, your whole life, the very way your body throbs right now, the very way the life energies happen, is being controlled by a million things around you. So unconsciously you have surrendered to it.
Tell us about your journey, your enlightenment. What was, you know, you're conducting courses, you have people who initiate aspirants, students. You had a guru, you learned yoga, you learned pranayam, and as you said, sort of seeking perfection of the mind and the body, and the enlightenment happened to you. Did you cultivate it? Did you seek it? Was it a spontaneous, you know, several hours that you then discovered was a much longer period of time?
I did not seek it, nor did I cultivate it. It's just by chance I came in touch with yoga when I was just 11 years of age.
Was the yoga a preparation for this, you think, in some ways?
Definitely. I would like to tell you how I came in touch with yoga. When I was a kid, when I was just 11 years, along with my, you know, a few friends and others, it was a sport for us to jump into a well, which was just about 8 feet in diameter, dropping about 70, 80 feet into the water. So it is dangerous. If you go the wrong way, your brains will become a smear on the wall. And to climb up again, because there is no steps or ladders or anything, to climb the rock, it's a difficult thing to do. It's something that we want to do, the boys. We're doing this, and I'm good at it. Then a man comes who is over 70 years of age, and he jumps in without a word, and he climbs up faster than me. I didn't like it. So I asked, okay, how? He said, come and do yoga. That's how I got into yoga. I'm saying this to you because it doesn't matter how you get into it, it still works because it's a technology. It is not a philosophy, it is a technology. If you employ the method properly, it'll naturally lead you on to a certain possibility.
So the assumption of a technology is sort of input-output. So are you… am I right in understanding that if those inputs of yoga and pranayam that you went through, that if any individual were to engage in those practices, they would have similar experiences to what you had at age whatever after so many years of doing that? Because the minute you call it technology, you're using a certain empiricism. You do X and you get Y. At a metaphysical level, when you start talking about karma and things, yes, in a much larger context, that's the way it ends up. But when you're looking here at techniques, saying that, you know, you do so many minutes of pranayam, you do so many minutes of yoga, and you do X, Y, Z, and this is what's going to happen, it happened to me. Is that what you're saying?
Yoga has a physical dimension to it and a subjective dimension to it. If you deliver the yoga without the subjective, then you go on doing it, your backache will go, you become strong and this, that, but the other aspects will not come. If yoga has been received, not learnt, if it's been received with the necessary subjectivity, it is bound to happen. There is no other way. So this is the reason why what we're doing right now is subjective. So the training processes are very long and rigorous. To train a simple teacher who has to teach just 5-day program, 5-evening program, we train them for 4 to 5 years of very intense training, full time. Because the subjectivity doesn't happen just with the physicality of yoga.
It's still my question then, if this is a technology…
Will it work for everybody?
And it's predictable. Is it predictable that you do these inputs and this is what is going to happen?
Now I have hundreds and thousands of people…
Who are enlightened as you are?
Who have experiences which are very high. People ask me, what's the mission? I tell them, my mission is to plant undercover yogis. Now I have housewives, bank managers, executives, scientists, tribal women, in very deep states of experience, very intense and blissful states of experience,
but how do
doing
they,
normal activity.
But tell us about what happened to you when you experienced enlightenment, and what followed, so that I may, you know, aspire to it one day too.
What because happened, you know, may sound very illogical and little crazy for people, but anyway, you're asking for it.
Mm-hmm. Not only am I asking for it, I'm saying that one day I want to get there too, because I want to be enlightened.
I was, you know, after I finished my education, got into business and much more successful than most people would have imagined in a short span of time, everything happening the way you want it. When everything that you touch is successful, generally you get into this mode that the planet doesn't go around the sun, it actually goes around you. So I'm in a condition like that. Everything that I do is success, I'm dead sure of who I am, what I am, all this. One afternoon, I'm just sitting on a particular rock in I come from Mysore, there's a hill called Chamundi. My eyes are open, I'm not doing anything yogic or meditation or anything, I'm just sitting with my eyes open. Till that moment, I always knew myself, me means this. Suddenly I did not know which is me, which is not me. What was me was all over the place. The very rock on which I was sitting, the air that I was breathing, the atmosphere, everything was me. That sounds loony, isn't it? What was me was just all over. I thought this experience lasted for about 5-10 minutes. But when I came back to my normal senses, 4.5 hours had passed. I sat there at 3 o'clock, I know that very well. It was 7:30 in the evening, my eyes are open. Sun has set, I'm fully conscious, but it's just that time just slipped by like that. This left me drenched in a completely different kind of blissfulness. For the first time in my adult life, tears were flowing. Tears and me are impossible. Me and spirituality cannot be, because even at the age of 4 or 5, I have questions. If my parents cannot answer questions, I will not enter the temples that they are visiting. I'll just hang around near the chappal stand for many hours till they come out, but I won't enter because they can't answer my questions.
You're watching a conversation with Sadhguru Jaggi Vasudev. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away.
Keep preparing.
Iron fist.
Challenging assignment.
Demands of peace.
Velvet glove.
Different roles.
When you see the pictures, you may also wish to know more about their world in the sun, rain and snow. So, in this program, we will bring you an insight into the world of men in uniform and developments that affect them and all of us, both in times of war and peace.
Welcome back to a continuing conversation with Sadhguru Vasudev. Tell us, you experienced the sense of your boundaries expanding. That's my paraphrasing of, I'm sure, an inadequate paraphrasing of something much more sort of profound, and we won't get stuck in semantics, blissful happiness or whatever. What happened then? What did you feel? You know, we're told that, you know, with the Buddha attained enlightenment under the tree, and he had to go through, you know, several years of extreme rigor and anguish and austerity and what have you. So in some senses you were lucky, probably, I don't know what, better karma or something?
Not lucky.
That, or better karma, hard work, that it happened?
That every aspect of your life, you can either conduct it joyfully, playfully, or in a very hard way.
That's it was playful and joyful and ease and happened apparently more easily for you. Then what happened?
Fundamentally, this is happening to any human being if he disassociates his intellect from every kind of identification.
But that again is you know, I understand what you're saying. I mean, I have no idea how to do it. I mean, I tell myself that's what I should do every morning. Nothing happens, and you know, obviously, I haven't had the right preparation, the right technique, or the right training. You know, so very often these are concepts, as you've yourself said, that you know, you can, you know, spirituality, teachers, scriptures can spout these, but until you really sort of truly, I don't know what, experience it, internalize it, practice it, it doesn't really happen. It happened for you. What happened then? What did you feel? We're told that, you know, Christ spent that many years, struggled till the time that he was on the cross. Poor Ramakrishna never quite made it and kept saying, ma, 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 till the time he was dying. The Buddha wondered whether he should go out and share it with the rest of the world or not. Would they understand? Did any of these sort of questions come up? What questions came up to you? You're unique.
I asked a million questions wherever I went and constantly got into trouble with everybody because I asked the oddest possible questions.
So what is the oddest one you asked that got you into the most trouble? Tell us.
This would be, my mother was a housewife, was totally dedicated to her husband and children. Absolutely, that kind of person she is. Totally devoted to everything that we are. But at the same time, in the Indian household, they are not given to I love you kind of expressions, you know. Mm-hmm. It's just, there's no question of your mother telling you I love you, it's just, it's there all the time, nobody even thinks about it. So one particular moment of something that happened, somehow she overstepped that and expressed a little bit of her love and
for
affection
you.
To me.
Ah.
I just asked her, if I was born in the next house instead of this house, would you still do this? Tears welled up in her eyes and she went away for some time. Then she came back and I was sitting there. I knew I asked something. As usual, I asked a question which unnecessarily disturbs people. And she came and she just fell at my feet and touched my feet. And she was still in tears and she went away. I thought that's good for her, at least, you know, some whatever illusions that you have about your love affairs and this, something broke. I'm just saying questions like this, I always question just about everything. These questions were not for fun for me, they were 100% genuine and very, very intense within me. If I had a question, I couldn't sleep the whole night, even as a kid. I would sit up the whole night.
These questions followed the enlightenment experience?
I'm saying these questions happened much before, when I was very young.
Mm. What happened after?
See, there are two aspects to me. This is a little difficult to explain in the sense, my memory has always been like this, that even things that happened when I was just 3-4 months of age are still in my memory. Not some great earth-shaking event, simple things, the local gossip that is happening, somebody came in, what kind of clothes they are wearing, simple, ordinary talk. Whenever I express, you know, this lady was saying this, my mother wouldn't believe me. You said you were just 3 months of age, how could you know?
Listen, you've got me tantalized. What happened after, after this moment in the Chamundi Hills? What happened after it was over and you experienced this?
See, this happened and I'm driving back and I'm so logical. I'm somebody who's been on European philosophy, you know, Camus, Kafka, Dostoevsky, this kind of stuff, which is all logically extreme. And spirituality is not the last thing, I've never heard about it. When I apply my logical mind, the only thing that my mind could tell me was maybe I'm going off my rocker, maybe I'm just losing my balance. When I shared this with the closest of my friends, the only questions that came to me was, did you drink something? Did you take some drug? This is the kind of things that came. So I knew there was no point talking to anybody, not even asking my mind the questions, because it always came up with the wrong thing. So I became like two. One was absolutely bursting with an exuberant experience. Another was totally confused and wanting to find an answer where there was no answer, and it was very clear to me, no matter how much I rake my brains, I wouldn't find an answer. So this experience started repeating itself. I sit here and I think it's 2 minutes, 7-8 hours are just gone. This, within about 6 weeks' time, the kind of change that happened within me was so dramatic. What happened within, I can never put into words, but physiologically, the kind of changes that had happened in my body were clearly visible for people around me.
Like what?
One thing, my voice changed dramatically, for no reason. And the shape of my eyes, if you look at the pictures, you can distinctly see the very shape of my eyes and face have changed. Not because of this neglect.
Is it neglect? Isn't that a part of our tradition that you don't, you know, you don't shave, you don't cut your hair?
It's not a part of our tradition. It's just that...
There is a belief that, you know, if you let your hair grow, then something will happen.
It's just that every male...
Too busy to do that.
Every male, naturally, these things happen to him.
Uh-huh.
Most people are removing it. I don't know why. Uh-huh. I didn't find a good enough reason to do that.
So these were the physiological changes that happened. And then what? Did you then decide that I now must make this available to other people? I must share it as an act of altruism?
One thing that
like
happened, which
thought?
Is something that I don't want anybody to believe, because I wouldn't believe it if anybody
well,
said this.
I'll believe
things.
You. Tell me.
A whole flood of memory came to me, lifetimes of memory, which completely my mind, logical mind, did not want to agree with, come to terms with.
This was before or after the experience?
This was after.
Because in traditional literature, it sort of precedes the, you know, sort of, I don't know, the karmic clearing.
Maybe
or what have
I
you.
Came the wrong way, I don't know.
No, but you know, that's...
I didn't know any spirituality.
Your living experience, and that is myth and legend, so we'll believe you. We'll follow your path, tell us.
It's before that I didn't know anything, but as weeks proceeded, every day became such a phenomenal thing for me. That I just want to sit, because I don't want to move around and miss the whole thing. I just want to sit in one place.
So was there ever a point of completion, that, you know, we started with this unbounded experience?
Yes,
and
I
then
said,
you go and
as I said,
thing, and then you say, okay, now this process is complete and I'm now ready for the world.
In about
I'm ready to come
weeks,
to the deer park.
In about 6 weeks of time, it became like a living thing. Till then it was like spurts, I don't want to miss it, I want to see what it is, confusion, mind and experience struggling with each other, because I had invested too much on my logical mind. I had invested too much in defeating everything that's around me. And that now it was trying to defeat me. So it was a big struggle for about 6 weeks. In 6 weeks it became like a living experience. Then there was no confusion. This is when a whole flood of memory just descended on me. The weight of the memory was little too much. Little too much, and it was so illogical and against everything that I stood for all these years.
So is that process complete now?
Very complete.
So what is the impulse to action? Just spontaneous? It just happens because you're...
Impulse to action is mostly people's longing. You see hungry faces. I think it's natural for a human being, if his humanity is in action, if his humanity is still functioning, if you see a hungry face, to feed them is very natural.
Ah, so you heard my longing to talk to you. You heard the voice.
I'm talking about more basic hunger that we see in 50% of the population.
I can assure you, you know, that the longing...
If you see a sick person,
the longing
to
nurture
that
the
words is
natural. Of wisdom is, you know, is an extremely powerful yearning.
What I'm
yearning.
Saying is, this is natural in every human being. He kills it with his psychological process, with his ideas, with his identifications. Why should I do this? Who the hell is he? All these things. If you don't have a psychological process, it is very, very natural for you, if you see a hungry person, to feed, if it's possible, if you see somebody in distress, to do something. It's very natural for a human being. So all I'm doing is a natural human expression that every human being should be doing.
Is there anything left? You're sort of about 50, now the 50 years of living, something more that you seek, something different?
Not really. The way I am made, if I sit here and close my eyes, I can sit here like this till I fall dead.
Oh my goodness.
I am made like this. I have simply no need for action, but at the same time I am all action, because it's still needed. I would like to see a day when I'll be unemployed and I can just sit.
Sadhguru, thank you very much. This has been a great learning and a great blessing. Thank you truly.